Having spent 6 years as chair of the Telecommunications Subcommittee, I'm really proud of the bipartisan work we did together to open up spectrum for advanced communications, enact FirstNet, our first responders' new interoperable broadband network, and to expand access to high-speed internet, although obviously much work still remains to fully connect all Americans to high-speed broadband. With the Ray Bombs Act, we even reauthorized and modernized the FCC, and as you heard, that hadn't been done in a couple of decades. When I had the great privilege and honor to chair the Energy and Commerce Committee, we took on the deadly epidemic of drug overdose and combined more than 60 bipartisan pieces of legislation into the Support Act, which, while focused on the opioid crisis, actually was much bigger than that and provided support for our communities to help all with addiction. We modernized our mental health laws, stepped up medical research, and fully funded the Children's Health Insurance Program for a decade, something that had never been done before. We modernized the FDA and its approval processes for medicines and medical devices, and thank goodness we did. Some of these changes have already proved their value during this pandemic. And I'm proud to have done my part to help enact Medicare Part D, which finally brought more affordable medicines to America's seniors. While we need to update this law, it is a fact that Medicare Part D has been a godsend to seniors who no longer have to board buses to foreign countries to get life-saving medicines. We also unleashed a cleaner energy revolution in America that created thousands of new jobs and reduced America's carbon emissions, too. Energy innovation holds the opportunity for a strong economy and a healthier environment. Mr. Speaker, as you can tell, I'm pretty passionate about good public policy. I've really enjoyed this opportunity and serving with all of you. And I think we can use our resources we have among ourselves in Congress to get good things done for the American people. It wasn't easy to decide to voluntarily leave this wonderful institution, but I'd long ago decided I didn't want to get voted out, and I don't think that was going to happen, or carried out. I was confident I'd win re-election. My health is good, so I leave on my own terms, feeling good about that which I've helped to improve the lives of those who entrusted me election after election, and I leave feeling positive about the ability to get good policy done right here in the U.S. House of Representatives. In fact, we just worked through a slate of bipartisan bills again today. I'll miss this process, and I'll miss you, my colleagues. Always remember how important it is, the work you do here, and how much the fate of American way of life rests in your hands every time you put that voting card in one of these machines. I'm a big fan of Theodore Roosevelt. His writings have also had an impact on my life. Just as my high school advisor encouraged us to fill leadership vacuums, so did Roosevelt laud those who climbed into the arena. So I close with President Roosevelt's words. It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes up short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. God bless you, my colleagues, family, and friends, and may God bless the United States of America, and I yield back.